with its steep tracks, many water crossings, ever-changing scenery and awesome views. It's easy to see why this is one of Australia's most iconic four-wheel drive destinations. This is the Victorian High Country. Got into camp last night about 6 o'clock. Tom Groggin Campground it is. Didn't film too much last night because it was just too dark. We set up camp, had something to eat, just went to bed. This morning the kangaroos are out everywhere. It's such a nice place here. Looking forward to going across the Murray River this morning and check out what the Victorian High Country's got to offer. It's the first time we've been to the Victorian High Country. It's a place I've always wanted to explore with the abundance of tracks and spectacular scenery. It took us around 9 hours to get here from Sydney with stops along the way with our 6-month-old. Charlie, Josh and I are in the wild track. Along with us this trip is Rob and Nicole, who drove down from Brisbane the night before. They're in their trusty Triton. We were keen to get across the Murray River and hit some of these Victorian tracks. The water levels aren't too bad at this time of year and we had no hesitations driving on through. The water looked crystal clear and very inviting, but being so close to winter, it was absolutely freezing and there was no chance any of us were going in for a swim. After crossing the Murray River, we headed down to Tom Groggin Track and we were heading for Mount Pinabar Track. The plan for the day was to get to the top of Mount Pinabar, then onto Mount Gibbo Track and head down Pheasants Creek Track for the night somewhere down there.
minus four in the wind here at Mount Pinabar. Absolutely freezing, but well worth the drive, and what a view. Down, head across to Mount Gibbo and try and find a nice spot out of this wind. A bit lower, try and get some lunch. Gibbo track. It's a diamond track, but it's probably medium, really. Low range, just take the right lines. Heading across to Pheasants Creek track now. This is a track that I was keen to explore. It's very steep heading down to where we camped for the night, and it's very steep heading back up again. However, we had a camera malfunction and lost all the footage. I'll just have to get it again next time we come. When we came across this sign, we weren't sure what to expect. Just following the JP Gap track at the moment. We're heading to Lake Dartmouth. It should be about 2 hours. The track's got a few steep parts, sections in it, but nothing too difficult.
Queensland. Okay. When's that? That's just this year.
So there's a book for people to visit the hut. After taking the wrong line, Rob ended up on the side of this mud pit. It was just a quick winch to pull him out and we were back on our way. But it just goes to show how important it is to take the right line. Thank you. got to Lake Dartmouth following 8 Mile Creek Road. It's a nice camp area down the end of the track. This lake is huge, nearly 8 times larger than Sydney Harbour. It stores its water from the snowfields and released in summer down the Mittamitta River and Hume, eventually making its way to the Murray. We saw trout and perch jumping all day. I guess it was a missed opportunity, so we didn't have our fishing gear. For dinner on this night, we decided to make some pizzas. We used Lebanese bread for the base with barbecue sauce. We had all the usual toppings, ham, cabanossi, pepperoni, mushrooms, capsicum, onion, corn and pineapple, topped with delicious tasty cheese. We were pretty hungry after the day exploring, and there was a small moment of relief by all of us when we lifted the lid and saw the delicious pizza cooked to perfection. We then enjoyed a few drinks, relaxing by the fire for the rest of the evening. The next day we headed to the famous Blue Rag Range track. After airing down the tyres, we were on our way. It was a beautiful sunny day today. We were hoping to get some good views from the top of the ranges. Blue Rag Range track itself isn't anything too difficult. It's a good low range track with some steep sections, but there were some areas you really needed to take your time to navigate around. We didn't head all the way down to the end of the track. The views were amazing from this spot on the helipad. Such a clear day. After a quick bite to eat, we headed back. Coming into Mount Hotham, we stopped for a few photos. We decided to build a snowman with what we could find. We also thought it was a good idea to be snow angels. That was freezing. Then we had a snow fight, which warmed us up again. We finally made our way down to the iconic Dargo Hotel. We all enjoyed a beautiful lunch, washed down with a couple of well-deserved beverages. After refueling in Dargo, we followed the Crooked River, winding our way along Wanagatta Road. We made it to Kingwell Bridge and decided it was better to cross the river instead of taking the bridge. We found a nice spot for the night opposite. Once again, we lost all the footage to this track. Billy Goats Bluff track is a low range track with decent clearance needed. Care has to be taken in some parts. After finishing Billy Goats, we followed Morocco Road to Morocco Hut. It was only an easy 20 minute walk each way. We found some wombat holes and the scenery was absolutely beautiful. There was even a nice little bridge to cross over to get to the hut. We stopped at Howard's Hut. Once again, it was a beautiful day, so we decided to have some lunch before making our way to Lovick's hut for the night, which was just over an hour up the road. We finally made it to Lovick's hut. The view was amazing here, but it was so cold this high up in the mountains. We decided to set up camp and get the fire going in the hut to keep us warm. We cooked up some dinner, had a few drinks, and just went to bed. I was surprised it didn't snow. These huts are scattered all over the high country. They're pretty cool, and I can see how it would just help someone if they needed some shelter. Just a shame no one replaces the wood that they use. We came up Monument Track, heading for Craig's hut. This is probably the most iconic hut in the high country, being famous for the movie The Man from Snowy River. Once again, the views are just amazing. We made our way across to Lake Eldon and found a nice spot to camp for the night. It was close enough to the water, but out of the wind. We even met some of the locals. The next day we headed for the Great Ocean Road, stopping at this famous surfing beach. I have no idea why it's so special. We made our way to Tanner's Road Campground and set up camp for the night. This had designated campsites, fire pits, and drop toilets. The following day we visited the lighthouse at Lorne and drove past the famous Great Ocean Road log sign. We visited the Otways National Park and walked down to the waterfall. We followed the Great Ocean Road and stopped at viewpoints along the way. We found beautiful boardwalks along the beach. followed some of the Otway's windiest roads. After exploring the area most of the day, we found a few easy tracks until we hit this track on the side of the road. It was a slushy and rutted out track. We took our time and I still nearly managed to roll the truck. Gibson Steps takes you down to the base of the 12 Apostles. It's an easy 10-minute walk down to the bottom. After a long day exploring the Great Ocean Road, we decided to head back and find camp. We stayed at a nice park and dried all of our wet gear. The next morning, we packed up camp and made our way to the end of the Great Ocean Road. We had some lunch and started to head to the Grampians to end our trip. If you've enjoyed this video and would like to see more, hit the like button and please subscribe to the channel. It really helps it grow.